Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to welcome you kindly to the presentation of Mr. Gautam Karmakar on the subject, The Journey of Indian Poetry in English. The two-year center, Russian Language Poetry in Transition, focuses on the study of contemporary poetry in Europe, but also in the Americas and East Asia. But we're interested not only in the poetry of the countries in these regions, but also in transnational poetry. This includes Russian or English or French and so on, language lyric poetry written in countries other than the home countries of that language. Today we have for the first time a lecture from India and about poetry in India. This is something completely new for us in Trier. We are really happy and grateful to welcome Mr. Karmakar today, and we are also happy to welcome the new guests from India and elsewhere who are attending an event of our center for the first time. Thank you all for being here. Today, Matthias Fechner is our moderator and he introduces our guest speaker. And so I hand over the floor to Matthias. Please, Matthias.
Yeah. Okay, well, thank you very much. And thank you very much, everybody who's managed to come here, and especially thank you, Donobat in Bangla, to Professor Gautam Karmakar. He is currently Assistant Professor of English at Barabasa Bikram Tudu Memorial College at Sidhukanu Birsa University in Purulia, West Bengal, in India. Purulia is a town which is situated 250 kilometers west of Kolkata, and it is also close to Shantiniketan, and it is therefore, one could say, a state, West Bengal, which has produced many great intellectuals, among others Rabindranath Tagore, who has founded an extremely influential university and school in Shantiniketan, which has also yielded great influence on German education studies. And besides, it is also the hometown of Nobel Prize winner Amartya Sen. However, Gautam Karmakar has done his PhD at the National Institute of Technology in Durgapur, and he has specialized on contemporary poetry in English in India. But he is also a prolific writer. He is a poet. He has conducted interviews with the famous poets writing in English in India, among others, Kiki Deruwala, T. Vasudeva Reddy, the Indian Keats, Arvind Kumar Chaudhary, Sunil Sharma, among many, many others. And today he's going to give us a brief overview on the history of English language poetry in India, commencing in the 19th century and ending, well, today, on this very day. Thank you very much. Gautam Karmakar.
Thanks a lot. And thanks for this wonderful introduction. And at the same time, thanks a lot for doing so much research on Purulia and also its surrounding places. Yes, it's a beautiful place and do welcome here. I'm really welcoming all. And thanks the DFC Center for Advanced Studies, Russian Language Poetry in Transition for cordially invites me to this live lecture on the journey of Indian poetry in English, a brief overview. And I want to thank Professor Henrika Stahl, the professor for Slavic Literature, School of Humanities, and University of Trier. And at the same time, she is also the project director and speaker of BFC Collect Research Group, FY2603, Russian Language Poetry in Transition. Poetic Forum addressing boundaries of genre, language, and culture across Europe, Asia, and the Americas. At the same time, I'm thankful to Katina Baharova, she's the Academy Coordinator, and Dr. Matthias Fechner, he's the Associate Researcher, and the whole team working behind this virtual platform for not only putting together this wonderful lecture series, but also for doing significant research work on poetry in general. Thanks for the warm invitation and thanks for introducing me with the audience. The kind of work that we were all doing on a global platform like this during this severely distressed and testing time is extremely praiseworthy and inspiring one for all of us. Now, am I audible and am I visible?
Yes, absolutely.
Okay, thanks. So before going to begin my talk on the journey of Indian poetry in English, a brief overview, I'm honestly confessing the fact that that it is not at all possible for me to tell you all about the trajectory of this genre, which carries a history of 175 years. And this talk of some of the major Indian poets writing in English can be taken as a humble attempt to reveal the poetic talents belong to this genre. And for this talk, I have divided the area into two sections, namely the pre-independence Indian poetry in English and the post-independence Indian poetry in English. And if we want to understand certain nuances of post-independent Indian poetry in English, we have to know and the growth and development of pre-independence Indian poetry in English. And this talk further will also trace the chronological history of Indian poetry in English, and here the reason for choosing it, that I think that perhaps most of the participants are not aware of the fundamental nuances of this glorious genre. And so a historiography will certainly convey the general outlines of this genre, and upon which and upon that the history, any kind of research work can be done. So medium, honestly speaking, remains a matter of inner compulsion, and no writing can be a good one if it distorts the truth, inhibits response, and doesn't create what in reality it pretends to delineate. In the early years of Indian literature in English, it was poetry more than any other genre which attracted the writers most. And the writing of English verse proved to be the first response that India gave to the world after the introduction of English into the education system. And from the very beginning, the diverse sociolinguistic makeup of India make Indian poetry in English a significant occurrence. Now, building a bridge between South and North India at national level and the East and the West at large, the poetry can be divided, or the 175 years of history of Indian English poetry can be divided into two parts, namely pre-independence Indian English poetry, that is from 1820 to 1947 is the year when we got the independence, and post-independence period, that is from 1950 onwards. And furthermore, this post-independence period can be subcategorized as modern period, it means 1950 to 1980s, and postmodern period from the late 1980s. And theme-wise, Indian poetry in English can be said to have three phases, namely the imitative phase, secondly the assimilative phase, and thirdly the experimental phase.
Hello, sir. Excuse me.
Hello. Yes.
Sir, sorry to interrupt. Can I know just the part that you have started now? Can you just repeat it again? I just didn't get it through the internet. Yeah. Thank you, sir.
Okay. So you were asking about those three parts, I guess. Theme-wise, I guess Indian poetry in English can be divided into three parts. That is that imitative phase, when we used to imitate British romantic poets. Secondly, the assimilative phase, when we used to mix our emotions and feelings of the East, and we also at the same time capturing the essence of the West. That's a kind of assimilative phase, or it's a mixed phase. And the third one, that is extremely postmodern period. And on this period, I have also done my doctoral research. That is the experimental phase. So the period from 1850 to 1900 is the imitative period, because Indian poets then imitated the British romantic poets like Shelley, Byron, and Wordsworth. After 1900, Indian poets began to assimilate the romanticism of the early 19th century poets and the new romantics also at the same time. And thus they tried to express the consciousness of Indian Renaissance between political changes and at the same time nationalism, which finally led to independence in 1947. Now I'm going to tell you something about these two phases, that imitative phase and the assimilative phase. At the initial stage, the Indian English poetry came under the influence of British poets, resulting in the lack of individuality and identity of Indian poets in English. That time, they are only imitating those British romantic poets, but an unmistakably authenticity of feeling is clearly visible in their poems. The first and second phase of Indian poetry were largely can be taken as an urban phenomenon that centered in Calcutta. And it can be said that by a few Calcutta-based Bengali families, the poetry was flourished at that time. I'm talking about Sharadchandra Chattopadhyay, Bankimchandra Chattopadhyay, I'm talking about Rabindranath Tagore. That time, in the very beginning, that poetry was centered around some people or some poets, those who were living in the then Calcutta. And after that, the focus shifted to Bombay and Madras. And while we are talking on Bombay and while we are talking on Madras, those are the poets like in the postmodern period, K.K. Endarwala, Nizam Ezekiel. These poets have come to the fore at the same time, Adil Jusawala. But all these poets are somehow related to post-independence Indian English poetry. So the Indian English poetry remained largely urban at the very beginning. And the poetry and the period of literary renaissance can be taken as the first phase of Indian poetry in English. And it becomes with Henry Louis Diderot's poems and later Michael Madhusudan Dutta's The Captive Lady, Kashiprasad Ghosh, The Share of Minstrel and other poems, Manmohan Ghosh's love songs or elegies are a testimony to the creative upsurge kindled by that time's literary renaissance. Now, Toru Dutta is one such poet whose poems show us the Indianness on a large scale. All the poets now I'm talking about, they belong to pre-independence period. And apart from Toru Dutta in that phase, the poets of the second phase are namely Sarojini Naidu, Harindranath Chattopadhyay, Rabindranath Tagore, and Aurobindo Ghosh. They were still romantic in nature, but their works were coupled with mysticism, nationalism, and spirituality. This phase was somewhat different from the first phase because Indian nationalism or Indian romanticism began to flow here. While Tagore was in search of beauty in nature and human, Rishi Aurobindo or Aurobindo Ghosh was in search of divine in man. Sarojini Naidu, in a very romantic way, portrayed Indian life, customs and surrounding. Coming under the influence of Urdu, Persian and English poetry, Sarojini Naidu developed a fine ear of verbal melody. The poets in this phase not only delineate Indian ethos and cultures, but also depict society in their best possible way. It can be asserted that Naidu and Toru Dutta formulate a kind of watershed between the first two phases, and their work showed their preceders' nostalgia and their successors' quest for identity and a sense of pride. So at the very beginning, due to the dominance of British Empire, the Indian poets writing in English were not given the national identity. I'm talking about the very beginning phase. Their writing were considered only tributary to the mainstream of English literature. Only in 1780s, India's newspaper Hickey's Bengal Gazette was bought out in English. And in 1817, the Hindu College, which later became Presidency College, was founded in Bengal. In 1835, Viceroy Macaulay, in his famous minute, laid the foundation of modern educational system and decides to promote European literature through the medium of English language among the subjects. So you can see the trajectory that from the very beginning, we're not supposed to write in English. It's the process, and that is why I have also named the talk of my today's session. It's the journey of Indian English poetry, and the journey which began in 1817, it's also going. It is now increasing day by day, and now as we have emerged, or we have entered into the era of postmodern era, now in this experimental phase, we are doing experiments with poetry and form. But in the beginning phase, it was nothing like that. So ironically, over decades, English would become the medium of expressions in India. And while writing in English, the Indian poets in English need to maintain two related conditions. What are the 2 points? First, the English language has to be Indianized enough to capture the flavor of India. And secondly, Indian poets must have mastery over the English language. So Henry Louis Vivian DiRiggio, who is a Eurasian Christian poet, becomes the first significant poet of this genre. And in this case, let me tell you that while we are for a long time under the colonial hangover or under the imperialistic attitude, this kind of the way of telling English was to some extent was a challenging fact for us, and at the same time we always tried to give English an Indian touch. So that is why I guess you are not known to the fact that there is a famous novelist and his name is Raja Rao, and in his preface to Kanthapura he told that we cannot write like the English, we cannot speak like the English, we cannot think like the English. Here the English means the Britisher. But we can use or think or can relate in some kind of Indianized English. From the very beginning, Indian poets, while trying to write in a language that is not their own, they try to figure it out, keeping their emotions attached within the language or within the periphery of their diction and their dictum. So while I'm talking about Henry Louis Vivian DiRiggio, he's one of the first and foremost poets who have written in English, and his two poetry volumes are there, namely Poems that is published in 1827 and then The Fakir of Jangira, Metrical Tale of Other Poems that is 1828. So he expressed patriotic sentiments, aspirations, and nationalistic gene. He is also called the national bard of India because of his concern for nation's lost glory and his love for the nation. DiRiggio's poems are rich in imagery, diction, sentiments, replete with Byronic echoes and satire. Like DiRiggio, Kashiprasad Ghosh is there. He also depicts India and her natural scenario. He also depicts Hindu festivals and customs in his poem. After Kashiprasad Ghosh, there is Sosri Chandra Dutt and his miscellaneous poems. Then there is Rajnarayan Dutt and his Asim or the Arabian Tales poem. I'm also telling some of the name of the poetry collections of the poets written at that time. I'm also taking this lecture as the preamble or the introduction which we can trace the historicity of Indian English poetry, and that is why I'm telling it by keeping in mind all the year and the name of the volumes. So after all these poets like Hurchandra Dutt, Sosri Chandra Dutt, there comes an excellent Bengali writer and the author of the Bengali epic Meghnad Bostam. His name was Michael Madhusudan Dutt. And with his two long poems, that is Vision of the Past and The Captive Lady, he becomes an interesting archetypal figure in Indian poetry. And in presenting historical aspect of India, Michael contributes significantly to the pre-independence Indian poetry. The Dutt family album is a collection of 197 poems of three brothers, Govind Chandra Dutt, Hur Chandra Dutt, Gris Chandra Dutt, and their cousin Omesh Chandra Dutt. Was a piece of religious dimension which throws light on the natives of India. This volume creates an ideal literary atmosphere for the blooming of the young talents like Toru Dutt and Oru Dutt. These two sisters have contributed largely to the growth and development of pre-independence Indian English poetry. And Oru Dutt's eight poems are framed and featured in Torudat and the sip gleaned in Krit fields. These are the poetry collections. And one of the notable aspects of Torudat's poetry is her use of rich Indian heritage of folklore and myth. Her diction is naturally of the Victorian Romantic school, and she projects her skill in using various forms like blank verse, ballad, and the song. Torudat's childhood memories, her commitment to her motherland, and the sense of her roots find expression in many of her poems. And in his like the Indian Muse of the English Girl, and in some other volumes, he criticizes his society on a large scale. After that, there are so many poets who contributed largely to the growth of pre-independence Indian English poetry. And in between them, those, there is another poet, his name is Ramesh Chandra Dutt, and he aims to produce condensed versions of the Indian epics, and he translated Prakrit and Hindu classics, and the translation are published in The Lays of Ancient India and so many other poems. After Ramesh Chandra Dutt, there comes Manmohan Ghosh, and later, after the death of Manmohan Ghosh, now, the entry of Manmohan Ghosh tells us two things. First of all, his poetry collections like Prem Bhira, Love Songs of Elegies, and Songs of Love and Death are worthy enough to prove his poetic acumen. And he wrote many on the English countryside and remains a dedicated poet of ambitious works. And this kind of dedication urges his brother to write also at the same time. And Manmohan Ghosh's brother, Aurobindo Ghosh, is one of the greatest Indian poets writing in English. Aurobindo Ghosh writes epics, long narrative poems, sonnets, lyrics, and dramatic poetry during his poetry career of over 55 long years. Some of his notable collection of poems are songs to Mithila, Urvashiya poem, Baji Prabhu, Chitrangada, Love and Death, poems, collected poems and plays, poems of past and present, last poems, and the most notable of all this, Savitri, that is written in 1954. His Savitri is a legend and a symbol, a work of 20,000 lines in 49 cantos. Can you imagine? It's some kind of second, second fairy queen that you come to know. It's a work of 24,000 lines in 49 cantos spread over 12 books. It's a masterpiece. And apart from that, Rishi Aurobindo Ghosh is also a philosopher. That is why he's called Rishi. He's a mystic also. He's a yogi also. He's a translator, sheer mystic and a critic. And his evolutionist yoga or his yoga philosophy is relevant to all the ages. As the head of Sri Aurobindo Ashram at Pondicherry, he establishes an original school of thought and religious sect. Ghosh is also known for his revolutionary activities in Indians' freedom movement. And if Aurobindo Ghosh is one of the greatest poets, then Sarojini Naidu is one of the eternal figures of Indian women poets writing in English before independence. She is also a notable politician of Gandhian period, and her poems are the specimen of anti-intellectual aesthetics of ephemeral view. And as a lyric poet, she has full control over rhythm and meter. And melody, along with the sense and sound, give her poetry an emotional aura and a musical wave. Her poetry also expresses many facets of love, and her imagery is sophisticated and at the same time stylish. Her poetry volumes are The Golden Threshold, The Bird of Time, Songs of Life, so many other poems are there. I'm not going to mention about the name of the poems because I have so many things to tell, and I know maybe 2 hours is not enough to tell also all this. After Sarojini Naidu, now we are entering into an era of Rabindranath Tagore. He is a poet, dramatist, he is a novelist, short story writer, he is the painter, he is the composer, translator, he is the nationalist, he is the thinker, he is an educationist, and he continues to inspire Indian poets writing in English in the first half of the 20th century. He is a bilingual writer, and only one poem, The Child, he writes in English. Apart from that, he wrote mainly in Bengali. He himself translated his works along with others' work, and those are the famous Gitanjali, The Gardener, The Crescent Moon, Chitra, 100 Poems of Kabir, Fruit Gathering, Stray Birds, Lover's Grief, Crossings. These are some of his notable poetry collections. In 1913, for Gitanjali, he wins the Nobel Prize for Literature. Tagore's verse in literature has a lyrical quality, and Tagore deals with passion, seriousness, and simplicity. Another well-known poet of the pre-independent era is Harindranath Chattopadhyay, and his poetry collections like The Magic Tree, Springs in Winter, The Feast of Youth, those are some of his major poetry collections that deal with Marxist ideology, spiritual truth, idealism, beauty, nostalgia, melancholy, and humanitarian. Apart from all these poets, there are so many other poets like Nijamajung, Swami Vivekananda, J. Krishnamurti, those who write poems and they explore Indian and Oriental notions in their work. So, this is more or less the history of pre-independence period, which gives this genre a name. The pre-independence period laid foundation for the poets who came after 1947 to give this genre an identity. And by learning, absorbing, and imitation from the West, Indian poetry in English begins to pave its way. With the advent of post-independent era, Indian poetry in English gained a new direction. And in 1958, Purushottam Lal and his associates founded a publishing house, namely Writers' Workshop. This is the one of the famous publishing houses that still used to publish Indian English poetry rapidly. If we consider or if we measure the standards of publishing house in India in terms of poetry, Sahitya Academy comes the first. And after Sahitya Academy, Writers' Workshop. And almost all the notable poets in the pre- and post-independence period, for their debut collection or their 2-3 collections, in a simultaneous way, have been published by Pilal from his Writers' Workshop in Kolkata. And this house becomes the platform for modernist poetry. Poets in this period begin to experiment with their forms, their meter, and their incorporate, and they incorporate themes and techniques of major yes. Is there any question? Am I audible and visible?
Yes, but just continue.
Okay.
Yeah. I think what probably could help is the names are obviously familiar to you, but if you just could pronounce the names a bit more slowly.
Okay.
Yeah, because...
Actually, the problem is that I have prepared almost so many pages. There are so many things to tell. So this is the problem. I want to tell you everything about the history of Indian English poetry. Yeah. And this time constraint, this is one of the challenging facts also.
Yeah, it's horrible. I know. But it's just the names.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. So poets in this period began to... Now I am talking about the nuances of post-independence Indian English poetry. And in this period, poems begin to experiment with their forms and meter, and they incorporate themes and techniques of major 20th century modernists like T.S. Eliot and Ezra. The new poets of this era discovered the great body of French experimental poetry, and here they incorporated techniques from 19th century Lautréamont Rimbaud to the 20th century Surrealist and Dadaist. The challenging condition of the society urges them to explore new areas, and thus this age witnesses an overall change at the economic, political, social, and cultural level. This poet rejects the artificial and highly ornate style of their earlier generation and focus on the clear and common speech. Poetry in this era deals with commonplace and ordinary happenings of the day-to-day life. This age traces a journey of the poets from idealism to cynicism and from romance to satire. So their poems are still lyrical, but the lyricism here is coupled with intense personal thought, harsh text, concrete and precise feeling. The poets in this era, while giving importance to the needs of contemporary situation, also maintains a kind of continuity of the Indian tradition. So while dealing with some kind of realities of the society, their poems also get hold of certain Indian idioms and expressions. That is why Indian English poetry is highly Indian in nature. And themes like the spirit of nostalgia, the reformist idealism, the patriotic spirit of the pre-independence era are found missing here in the poets of post-independence era. These post-independent poets are not dealing with fact of nostalgia. They are not in a way to reform. They are not in a way to some patriotism. Because India always gained independence. With the moral fiber of the notion torn up social imbalance, moral disintegration, and economic inequality come to the fore, the poets rise to this occasion and they become the spokesperson of their dreams and their times and the visions of the society they are living in. So, before giving a brief overview of the major poets of this era, let us take a look at the factors responsible for the emergence of this experimental modernist new Indian poetry. Their voices are needed to gain social progress and economic progress, and for this, the rise in mass education and the government's policies of democratic socialism are needed. Though the overall progress, the broadening of the middle class section of the society can be achieved, they thought so. And scientific development and technoculture bring forth atheism and agnosticism among the educated intellectual. An open mode of expression in society is demanded. And to quicken the progress of modernism, the evolution of Indian language is justified, and English needs to be Indianized in intonation at the same time in case of pronunciation and syntax. So it's a fact that in this era, while the imitative period ranged from 1850 to 1950, or after that era, that experimental phase began in 1980s. And in this phase, all the poets with their grandeur, uniqueness, and thematic variations attempted to retain their distinctive identity of Indian poetry. Now, regarding the thematic variation, distinctive ranges, and power exhibited by poets in this phase, it can be told that the territory of Indian poetry in English is much larger and more vivid and more varied today than it was ever before. The new poets have found appropriate techniques for their perception of reality, and the range, the variety, the themes and voices of Indian English poetry have made great strides in recent decades. At the same time, it can be said that the new age of Indian poetry in English started with Nizam Ezekiel. And this is suggested in the title of Nizam Ezekiel's first poetry collection, A Time to Change. It is published in 1952. So 1952 symbolizes the time to change in the growth and development of Indian English poetry. And by discarding the influence of Romanticism and Victorian poetry, poets in the post-independent era attempt to conglomerate and interpenetrate English and Indian sounds, Indian cultures, and Indian ethos. they provide a different lexical content to the words used by them, and thus they acclimatize the foreign language to the native cultural overtones. Now, if in case of Indian poetry in English, Bruce King is one of the most reputed and well-acclaimed scholars of Indian poetry in English. And his modern Indian poetry in English, that's the prime and pivotal text that give us the basic nuances of how to read modern Indian poetry in English. And there, Bruce King also observes that the new poets who began to appear at independence were in love with English language, excited by late 19th and 20th century poets as Hopkins, Yeats, Eliot, Pound, and Auden. Their emphasis was more on the aesthetic. He talks about the pre-independence. The pre-independence poets are more keen on the aesthetic, ethical, and interpersonal than on politics, nationalism, and mythology. But the new poetry was part of post-independence modernization of Indian society and emerged first in and still a phenomenon of a larger urban India. So, with Pilal's writer's workshop in Calcutta, the age of modern Indian poetry in English began. And poets of this era believe that the English language has served the proposed through transgression, original writers and Indian sensibilities were expressed through the English language. The new poets with their word order, syntax, images, and symbols express their emotion, passion, experiences, which are truly Indian in nature. And new poets of this era were surrealist, and to some extent they are Dadaist. And even when they wrote antique or ancient poetry, they delivered it with a new urgency of utterance and a new note. The new poets saw the social, political, and religious corruption in society of that time. Distributional injustices were seen by them. They began to write on this topic. They believed that the period of Indo-Anglican Romanticism ended with Sarojini Nair. They rejected spiritual poetry along with weak-spined, greasy, rubbery, and blurred sentiments of pre-independence Indian poets writing in English. In this context, Shipke Kumar is one of the most notable poets of post-independent era. He says that the new poets were, they want poetry to be authentic. They want poetry to be intensely personal, and the poetry written in this era in a language shown of cliches and verbosity. And a poem for them must be skillfully structured artifact of both image and emotion, thought and feeling. And so the new poets were in utter shock when they found that the old moral values and ethics were lost. To break the new grounds, the new poets evolved new idioms, revolted against the inequalities, satirized a certain class, and adopted clear and common ways of expression to deal with the common place. The economic and political uncertainties disillusioned this new poet, and they used their poems as a medium of protest. They moved from... So basically, this experimental phase talked about the social realism, the Marxist approach of reading poetry. To some extent, this new generation of poets dealt with the negative issues of society, and their poetry become the poetry of protest. And this is what I have explored in my doctoral thesis, that the continuity of Indian poetry in English from Marxism to the era of post-Marxism, how Indian poetry in English is growing, and at the same, by leaving this imitative age, it is now satirizing certain institutions. And if I term it in terms of Louis Althusser, this new Indian poets have tried their best to decode that apparatus, that state apparatus, and that the ideological state apparatus, at the same time the state, the institution, the schools and society, all the state apparatus that used to exploit us, all are decoded by this new poem. So some kind of their poetry can be taken as a specimen where a kind of voice can be raised and their poetry becomes a poems of protest. And to some extent that I can, in my doctoral work, I have also given it. It's a kind of, if we have gone through to the poems of Caroline Fortune and her theory of poetry of witness, then we can understand that this kind of poetry, Indian English poetry, become the poetry of witness, where there this kind of poetry are not only showing all the negative aspects of the society, but at the same time, this poetry can help people to heal their wounds. So I have also tried to decode it in my research, that how this kind of poetry act as a kind of scriptotherapy. This poetry acts kind of therapy. So poetry can also be a medium or can be used as in a therapeutic way. And that also I have built in a separate section in my research. So the new poets, what I'm trying to say, that didn't condition the economic and political uncertainties and all this disillusion, the new poets, and they used their poems as a medium of protest. And they moved from idealism to cynicism. And here also we can tell that this new kind of experimentation in poetry writing by Indian poets doesn't create a hiatus between the old and the new, because it maintains a continuity of the Indian tradition while giving definition to the needs of the peasants that I mentioned in my work. That it's a kind of continuation. What kind of continuation? That the demand of the day, how Indian poets are trying to address the socialist, and even the poets who started writing as a traditionalist soon began to write in modernist technique. And this new mode of writing was adopted by them. Now that the new poets gave less importance to the content and form, was given more priority. And the new poets found no interest in poetic fancies, and they engaged themselves with social realism. Alienation, corruption, hypocrisy, subjugation of a particular class, exploitation of nature and image of India found expression in their work. The new poets showed their distrust of religious orthodoxy, and they were not familiar with transcendental philosophy. Rather, they paid attention to empirical or phenomenal reality. The society becomes their major concern, and Indian sensibilities were abundantly expressed in their work. They didn't think about the past, and they haven't thought about the future. So it is also, and now in this context, I can remember the name of that significant volume, the 10th-20th century Indian English poets, or 10th-20th century Indian poets, and by R. Parthasarathy, Rajagopal Parthasarathy, it becomes one of the major texts that the important characteristic of Indian words are expressed here. Rajagopal Parthasarathy, this anthology become one of the hallmark anthology. There are two anthologies on Indian poetry in English. There is one by P. Lal, one by Rajagopal Parthasarathy, one by Arvind Krishna Mehratra. So Rajagopal's anthology on 10th-20th century Indian poets, and there he has accommodated 25 modern Indian poets, and all the poets have contributed two or three poems, and the whole volume can give us a glimpse of the then condition of Indian English poetry. And furthermore, the new poets not only thought for the period which they belong, they also thought about the future also. And in an age of democracy, they advocated for their individual choices. And they, at the same time, they are trying to show their individual voices. And now, as I am also trying to extend my research on how this kind of that era of Marxism and from Marxism to post-Marxism, there's the continuity in this kind of continuity is not there only in Indian poetry in English. It is also there in the whole South Asian poetry. If we talk about the poetry of Bangladesh, or if we talk about the poetry of Pakistan, as for example, two, three pamphlets of Manto or Faiz Ahmed Faiz, all the poets have dealt with some kind of socio-reality portrayal. And so this kind of continuity can be traced in the whole gamut of South Asian poetry, And this is the era which is largely unexplored till now. Not a single research has been done. So this kind of work that should be done in a far more better way. So that on that periphery, Indian poets can be taken as one of the prime examples upon which the foundation can be laid. And this was begun by Nizam Ezekiel, was considered the father of modern Indian poetry. And after that comes A.K. Ramanujan, R. Parthasarathy, Jayanta Mohapatra, Shipke Kumar, Arun Kolatkar, Kamala Das, K.K.N. Daruwala, Dom Mores, G.F. Patel, Adil Jusawala, Pritish Nandi, Arvind Krishna Maharatra, Bibhu Padhi, Bikram Sheth, Niranjan Mohanty. These are the notable poets of post-independence. There are so many others, but these are the notable ones. Now, this poet showed their discomfort with the tradition, and they, in an ironical way, show that they want to choose Indian society, culture, customs, ethos, tradition as their subject matter, along with the chosen language of expression. Apart from showing the conflict between tradition and modernity, religion and skepticism, ironic stance and symbolic overturn, the self and the other, the bitterness of the society, and the revolt of the oppressed, these poets want to construct the image of India through their ornateness, through their allusion, and a subtle mode of negotiation. But after these poets, many new voices emerged, but questions are raised on the merit and status of new poets. In this context, I can tell you that it was also the last part of my talk. It will be, if the time permits, that there is a conflict of interest whether Indian English poetry is rapidly growing in the same way, and at the same time, apart from some well-known poets, there are some poets whose poetry can be taken because of some kind of conflict of interest, because the tilted trend of focusing on a very fortunate few alone most of the time is highly pernicious and practice pursued by the high-gross self-proclaimed and exclusive critics. And at the same time, so many poets are there whose poetry not getting enough attention. So many Indian poets are there. And in this context, let me shamelessly promote one of my book that I have recently brought out from Sahitya Academy. Is it visible? If it is, it is published from Sahitya Academy in 2020. And here in this book, I have accommodated 80 Indian poets. Among these 80 Indian, almost all these poets belong to post-independent era. And here I have tried my level best to show what the generation like P. Lal and other poets, they failed to provide. In all the volumes, mainly they have provided some 14 poets or some 15 poets. So anthology were somehow skeptic and nepotism and favoritism were there. So I have tried to deal in a very subtle way so that all the poets can be accumulated can be read within a single volume. And let me just read the 2-3 lines from the preface, that once a question can be aroused that why I have left behind poets like Nizam Ezekiel, Kamala Das, why I have left behind Jayanta Mohapatra, why I have left behind Arudhatta, those are great poets. I haven't chosen. Because I always believe that the number is not enough, because mapping the vastness of Indian poetry is not an easy task. But at the same time, I always remember what Arvind Krishna Maharatra once said, that to edit an anthology is an opportunity to revise the literary map, bring neglected works back in circulation, the shift the emphasis from certain poets to others. And this I do by leaving out poets like Nizam Ezekiel, A.K. Ramanujan, R. Parthasarathy, Dom Mores, Pritish Nandi, Kamalata, Sivnish D'Souza, Gauri Deshpande, Chipka Kumar, Arun Kolatkar, Jayanta Mohapatra, Advin Krishnamurthy, Agashayidali, Vikram Seth. I haven't incorporated all these poets, but I have incorporated all the new poets whose poetry needs to be read more and more. And I believe that what gives my selection a solid credibility is the juxtaposition of award-winning modern poets with postmodern and contemporary poets. Of course, some other noteworthy established and popular poets are not included, for which I apologize. Indeed, all those poets have been with me for over the years, but due to some unavoidable circumstances, they have not been included in this collection. And I can say that we shouldn't believe in the categorization of good poets and bad poets, because we should work together for the betterment of Indian poetry in English. And anthologies, I believe, serve to break the hierarchy that only a handful of Indian poets in English are worthy of inclusion. And for this reason, a second volume by God's grace may come out in near future. So in this anthology, there are 80 poets and there are a few diasporic poets also, like Mina Alexander, there is Sujata Bhatt, and now she is in Germany. And I think all of you are known to the poetic nuances of Sujata Bhatt. So, and Imtiaz Darkar is there. So I have taken all those diasporic poets like Usha Kishore, Usha Akela, Devjini Chatterjee. They are there in this poetry volume. Now, let me back to my talk is it an interesting one or it's a kind of boring one? Because I think while we are trying to listen to something new, often we fail to cater our own interest to that era. So I think many of the poets are unknown to all, and so I guess it can be a bit boring also to some extent, if I am not so wrong. So, after that, the poetry of Nizam Ezekiel and Pilal's poetry collection, like The Patriot's Death, Love the Death, Draupadi, and proved their master in rhyme. After that, Nizam Ezekiel's poetry collection, like A Time to Change, 60 poems, The Third, The Unfinished Man, The Exact Name, Hymns in Darkness. These are the poetry collection of Nizam Ezekiel. Later Desalam. So Nizam Ezekiel discusses his instant wishes, the present condition of the society, evils and vices of the society, day-to-day life situations, happenings, incidents, dark images, and economic inequalities, religious and political corruptions, social realities, and many more. And thus his poems have a therapeutic approach. He gives a universalized form to his feeling of depression and agony. In this context of Indian poetry in English, his one of the foremost contributions is the introduction of a new Indian English idiom. And apart from that, while we are talking about A.K. Ramanujan, he writes poetry in English too, and in his poetry collections like Striders, Relations, Second Sight, he also talked about his memories of childhood, his love for roots and family, mythology, psychology, spirituality, agony, self and individuality, and Indian sensibilities are found in their collection. Later, in the post-independent Indian English poetry, to some large extent, is dominated by Kamala Das. Kamala Das is the pioneer of post-independence Indian women poets writing in English, and her summer in Calcutta is followed by The Descendants, The Old Playhouse and other poems, The Stranger Time, Collected Poems, Only the Soul Knows How to Sing, My Mother at 66, and her autobiography, My Story, portrays her unhappy marriage life on a large scale. Her poetry deals with the pathos of life of women, feminine sensibilities, unfulfilled desire, loneliness, emotional defeat, agony and frustration. Apart from that, there are so many other women poets of this era. And what are they? They are Eunice D'Souza, They are Mina Alexander, Mamta Kalia, Sujata Vartata, mentioned earlier also, Moshe Chaturvedi, Shukrita Pal Kumar, Mina Kandaswamy, Mamang Dai, Temsula Ao, Janice Pariyar, Chilota Krishnan, Devjani Chatterjee, Tishani Doshi, Bashobi Fresher, Nundini Shahu, Rukmini Bhayanayar, Gauri Deshpande, and Arundhiti Shubhan. These are the postmodern Indian women poets writing. Now, postmodern Indian poetry in English, to some extent, is dominated by Saitya Academy Award winner and Padmasri Award winner poet Keki Nasirwanji Daruwala or KKN Daruwala. And with his poetry collection like Under Orion, Apparition in April, Winter Poems, The Keeper of the Dead, Crossing of Rivers, Landscape, A Summer of Tigers, Night River Poems, The Map Maker, with all this, The Scarecrow and the Collective Poems. And so he tried to go with all these volumes, the various themes and his originality of insight, depth of feeling, mythopoeic imagination, satirical tone, ornateness, economy of language, Indian ethos and sensibilities, social awareness, narrative bent of mind, clarity and freshness, apt imagery and use of rhetoric give his poetic a universal appeal. Like KKN Daruwala, there is another noteworthy Indian poet of post-independent era, and he was Shiv Kumar Kumar. He was also the winner of Sahitya Academy Award for his Truffle in the Sky in 1987. And he also begins to write poetry, lately, and issues of women, poverty, social and economic inequalities, ecocentrism, cultural interaction, unrequisite love, aging, sexual deserts, Indian life, modern diction, lyricism, beauty, fluent and moving rhythm are found in his poetry. He is followed by, in the post-independence era, and this post-independent era of Indian poetry in English also witnesses the rise of Uriya poet. It means poet belongs from Odisha. And who write in English also, and notable among them were Jayanta Mohapatra, Bibhu Padi, and Niranjan Mohan. Jayanta Mohapatra is the first Indian poet writing in English to win the Sahitya Academy Award. And in 2009, he is honored with Padma Shri. In his collections like Close the Sky, 10 by 10, A Father's House, The Rain of Rides, Waiting, or in some other volumes, Jayanta Mohapatra tried to show his native land, Odisha, along with the landscape, temple, surrounding, custom, meat, tradition. So mainly Jayanta Mohapatra, Bibhu Padi, and Niranjan Mohanty, all these poets, somehow they tried to show their root, their identity, and the identity of Odia people in general. Now, apart from all these poets, there are so many other poets. Those are also provide significant contribution to the growth and development of post-independence Indian poetry. And one of them was Arun Kulatkar. And Arun Kulatkar, with his poetry collection, the most famous poetry collection of Arun Kulatkar was Jejuri. With his publication of Jejuri, his excellent use of metaphor, minute observation, rational and skeptical outlook of the society, modernist thinking, clear and clever insight of poetic description. He tried to trace the truth of the religious practices going around the temple of Khandoba at Jejuri. So Jejuri is basically a collection of poems, 34 poems, dealt with the temple of Khandoba situated at Maharashtra. There is a temple and there is a name of the same name. It's the same name, Jejuri. And there he tried to show how a religion in India can be contrasted with certain kind of skepticism. Mainly it is a poetry volume of modernity and Indian tradition between superstition and rationality. how Indian people become superstitious, but they need to be skepticist and some kind of logistic to some extent. Apart from them, his other poetry collections, I'm talking about Arun Kulatkar, and his other poetry collections are the Boat Ride and Other Poems and Collected Poems in English. Those are published in 2008 and 2010. Post-independent era of Indian poetry in English also witnesses the rise of many Indian poets like Dilip Purushottam Chitra, and one of them. He is a bilingual poet, critic, painter, and filmmaker. And apart from Dilip Purushottam Chitra, there are so many other poets like R. Parthasarathy, who has also edited that anthology, 10th to 18th Century Indian Poets. And R. Parthasarathy, with his famous poetry collection, he has a single poetry collection, famous poetry collection, that is Rough Passage. That is published in 1977. That portrays the poet's loneliness. Parthasarathy was somehow desperate. Staying in England, and at the same time, he was Tamil by origin. So his Rough Passage, with the three volume, it means exile, trial, and homecoming. There are three plot. There are three sections in Rough Passage. One is exile, another is trial, and the second and the third one is homecoming. So it's a gradual development of a poetic mind. How a diasporic poet feels lonely for his motherland, and how he tried his best to create a bridge between his Tamil identity and his identity that he gained in a foreign land. So it's a kind of poetry collection that deals with his loneliness, his alienation from native land, his rootlessness, his identity crisis, and finally his return to the Tamil culture. This kind of rootedness finds expression in the poems of Aziz Jusawala. And his famous poetry collection, The Trying to Say Goodbye, published in 2011, is the finest example of this. And in 2014, he is honored with Sahitya Akademi Award for this book. With collections like The Right Kind of Dog and I Dreamed a Horse Fell from the Sky, he shows his mastery over language, his novel thoughts, ideas, vision, symbolism, rhetoric, all are beautifully merged in simplicity and idea. Born in the year 1940, Yeh Patel is another noteworthy Indian poet of this era. And the Jeev Patel's poetry, his poetry collections like poem, How Do You Withstand Body, Mirrored Mirroring, he shows the importance of the human body, mind, and family relations, God, religion, and nature vividly. So Jeev Patel's poems are to some extent are ecological in nature also. And that is why Jeev Patel belongs to a group of poets that is named as Green Poet. Because if we come across this one single poem on killing a tree, Jeev Patel has tried to show ecological awareness among us and what can be the both consequences of killing a tree. So this kind of poets are basically trying to show a kind of green awareness among us. And apart from that, there is also Arvind Krishna Mehratra and his works like Nine Disclosures, Distant, Instated Milus. All the poems, these poetry collections are written in 1976, 1988, or 1994, or the collected poems in 2014. So these are the modern poets of this era. But Arvind Krishna Mehratra is tough to read because of his thought pattern, his use of metaphors, simile, his abstract visions with concrete symbols, his precise imagery, and his eco-sensibility coupled with Indianness and meaning. Now, there is a poet, perhaps we have come across to some extent, that the Kashmiri American poet Agha Shahid is one of the major figures of Indian poetry. Agha Shahid Ali and his works like, namely, work through the yellow pages, are nostalgic maps of America, the country without a post office, discusses history, myth, memory, nostalgia, moments of the past, family, ancestors, self-consciousness. So many things are there in the poetry of Agha Shahid Ali. And Agha Shahid Ali's poetry are the poetry of protest, because Agha Shahid Ali always tried to show the conflict, the issues, the political turmoils of Kashmir, one of the most political turmoil place in India. And Kashmir is a place regarding which India and Pakistan are continuously fighting for a certain kind of land, and belong to that place. Agha Shahid Ali's poetry, to some extent, talks about the people living in Kashmir, talks about how the Kashmirians are faced with so many problems. And while reading Agha Shahid Ali, one can remember poets like Faiz Ahmed Faiz of Pakistan. He is also dealt with same kind of thing. Apart from Agha Shahid Ali, there are another poet, that is Pritish Nandi. Pritish Nandi is a filmmaker also here in India. First he was a poet, and later he became the filmmaker and producer also. And his poetry collections like Of Gods and Olives, Of Other Side of Arrogance, Dhritarashtra Downtown, Madness in the Second Stroke, Pritish Nandi 30. He talked about certain kind of experimentation, protest, individualism, metrical patterns, confessionalism, topographical rhythm, love, all this. Now there is another poet. Rather, he is more than a poet, than a novelist, and he is the author of A Suitable Boy, published in 1993. One of the all-time greatest novels of Indian literature in English. Yes, I'm talking about Bikram Seth. Bikram Seth is a poet, he is a novelist, and he is a receiver of several prestigious awards like Padma Shri, Sahitya Akademi, Prabhasri Bharatiya Sangha, W.H. Smith Literary Award. And in his poetry collections like Mapping, The Humble Administrator's Garden, All You Who Sleep Tonight, Beastly Tales, Three Chinese Poets and Summer Requiem, he discusses the motherland, historical incidents of India, nostalgic moments, animals, works of different poems, and anthropocentric attitude of humans, natural sounding, ecological views, and others.
Gautam, yes. may I just ask a question? And taking the danger that it might come over as a trifle rude. When do you expect your lecture to end so we could plan ahead?
Another 20 minutes? Within 20 minutes?
Another 20 minutes.
All right, then. Time is there.
I mean, it's an absolutely splendid lecture, and I'm quite sure that we could go on talking for hours, actually, after that. So the more input you give, the longer we'd have to talk, actually. But, okay, 20 minutes, right? All right.
No, if you can tell, then I can shorten, or it depends on you.
I'll leave that to you. I'll leave that to you. Go ahead.
Okay.
Just go ahead. Thank you.
Thank you. So now let me talk something about another conflicted zone. It is in Northeast India. Well, we are talking about the poetry of India. We need to know the Northeast period, that Northeast part of India, that is that the Seven Sisters, Assam, Arunachal Pradesh, Meghalaya, Manipur, Tripura, and these are the places where corruption, conflict, bloodshed, and violence have spilled over into everyone. And after independence, the problem of insurgency has made the lives of Northeast people. Look, there is Kashmir, another politically conflicted zone, and there is also Northeast part of India. So poets belong to Northeast part of India, like Mamangdai, Temsula Ao, like Ananoyes Guho, Robines Nangam, King Fung Singh Nongrit, they deal with the existential practices and their time and place, political and environmental issues, cultural and literary preferences, images and symbols of nature, impact of industrialization and urbanization, and so many other issues of Northeast part. So post-independent Indian English poetry also show that growth and development of Indian women poets also in general, and that I have also mentioned. Now, let me talk a bit about my doctoral research, since it is also that what I did in all those 5 or 6 years. So basically I tried to show the continuity or the social realism, and I tried to show that because of the poetry's involvement with the meter, rhyme, medium and subject matter, I think that as a member of society, a poet fails to ignore the influence of society upon him, and as a result, his or her poems reflect the realities of society. And to some extent, I think Matthias is also concerned with the social realities and social issues of the poet, because while I'm going through the works of Matthias Beat, I think to some extent he has also talked about the socio-realistic issues or the commitments of the poet. So in case of Indian poetry in English, I did the same. And the sensitive heart and intense feeling of a poet intensify his poems, and he tries his best to show how the shifting paradigm, the indispensable component of the dynamic of evolution, affect his poetry, society, culture, and literature of the period. And I think that Christopher Hampton, in his essay that I also mentioned in Poetry and Commitment, talked about that poetry doesn't exist in vacuum. Its utterances is dominated by the language and the sensibility of each poet, while in turn it is rooted in the language of his community and the conditions which define the life of the community. Poetry, in other words, is deeply involved in the structure of the world. It's a part of as the individual poet. To deny is to abdicate responsibility. And now, there are three parts. There are the conflict that also I have tried to show. What are the conflicts? That there are so many poets in that era that they are not doing this kind of things. They are only hankering after, these poets have no wish actually to make people aware of their follies. They are more interested to publish their poems at any cost and satirizing the difference of a few contemporary poets. R.K. Singh also observed that the second and first phase, in while I am talking about the experimental phase, there are three phases: first phase, second phase, and third phase. First and second phase, there are so many poets, they haven't talked about the social and political issues. But in the third phase, there are poets. Poets belong to the third phase, that is K.K. Indarola, Shibke Kumar, Jayanta Mohapatra, D.C. Champal, Shahid Amiruddin, I.K. Sharma, Pashupati Jha, T.V. Reddy, O.P. Bhatnagar, R.K. Singh, Baldev Sharma, and a few other poets attempt to depict the harsh realities of society. And they never fail to respond to situations of life with their thought-provoking and unbiased observations of society. And they uphold the bitter truth of society. They conform to the views of Lewis Mumford, who once says that it is better to face chaos courageously than to cherish the dream of returning to an outworn synthesis. So it was Nizam Ezekiel who first started to criticize the evil practices found in society. And he believes that poetry should be realistic, poetry should be logical, poetry should be reflective, and poetry should be grounded in reality. And while I'm talking about Nizam Ezekiel, I have to talk about Pushkin, because he also told that what Nizam Ezekiel brought, the same kind of feeling can be bought by the new poets with the sense of discipline and self-criticism and mastery to Indian English poetry. And after Ezekiel, there are so many poets and they never stay backward. And I have taken 5 poets for my study, and those are K.K.N. Darowala, Shibke Kumar, T.V. Reddy, Pashupati Jha, and K.V. Dhoni. And I have showed how these poets in a very realistic way depict the plight of the poor people, social injustices, political and religious corruption, exploitation of the mother nature, and experiment also about the pathetic condition of women and downtrodden people, war and this aftermath, cruelty to the domestic animals, loneliness in age-old homes. So basically, I have tried to explore 4 things in my research. Those are the prevailing social conditions and problems of society in the select poems of the above mentioned 5 poets, the trends of and various dimensions of social issues in the select poems of the above mentioned 5 poets, the various political, religious, cultural, and ecological perspective, problems and corruptions in the select poets, and the plight and struggle of the different sections of the society, and the ongoing hypocrisies of the society in the select. And now, in course of all these years with Indian poetry in English, I have come across with three books. And now let me allow to share my screen that I have prepared. That this was the talk, this was the period that I have divided pre and post. These are the pre-independence period. These are the major writers. Michael Madhusudan Dutt or some of them. This is Rabindranath Tagore. This is Rishi Aurobindo Ghosh. And I have come across, while doing my doctoral research and in all these years, I have produced three books on Indian English poetry. And number one is Making of the Indian Muse. And here, there I have divided four sections. That is mapping the history of Indian poetry in English. In part two, I have described pre-independence period and Indian poetry in English. And in part three, I have discussed about the modernity and post-modernity, about the post-independence era and Indian poetry in English. And part four, in part, till date, I have interviewed 26 living Indian English poets writing in English. And in this book also, I have accommodated a few conversations and I have given the name Writers in Conversation. And this is one of the blurb that about Elizabeth Merino has talked about my book. It's a kind of groundbreaking volume and all. That more or less basis about the book. This is my another book that has been published from USA in 2019 by Transcendent Zero Press. It's from Houghton. And here also, in the first book, I have tried to decode about pre-independent Indian English poetry in general. In the second book, that is Envisioning the Indian Muse, I have tried to decode the contemporary, look at the title, Essays on Contemporary Indian Poets Writing in English. Here I have tried to decode the contemporary poet. And there also I have divided the book into three sections. The first section about the panoptical study of Indian poetry in English. Second section, I have given the thematic variation of the select contemporary Indian poets writing in English. And in the third part, I had studied the Northeast Indian literature, and in part four also there is conversion. There is also one of the blurbs that I have mentioned. It's about written by Devjani Chatterjee. She is the poet, writer, translator, and Royal Literary Fellow at D. Montfort University, Leicester, UK. And I was invited by the same university in 2018 to deliver a talk there on the diasporic poetry. And there we met and we discussed this kind of project. And this is my last book, that is The Lie of the Land. It is published by Sahitya Akademi. And there also, I have accommodated 80 poets. And this is one of the blurbs that Professor Anishu Rahman, one of the greatest scholars of Indian poetry in English, written. And let me also tell you that regarding this book, the famous Bruce King has written the afterword of this book. And they are, with the last part of the book, in the afterword that I want to read, and there he talked that he has not praised my book. Only he told that anthologies have had a major role in the establishment and promotion of Indian poetry in English. Anthologies have been where the writers and the editors proclaim their words and taste. Each anthology is a selection, a defiance, a stout, an attempt to establish or change the canon. I have not attempted to discuss the selections in this anthology. Each editor, generation, or group offers some different taste or approach, a different poetic. By now, I and the poets I wrote about have become part of the literary scene. Some are said to be modern classic. I will not impose my taste and opinions here. The anthology, like any book, must stand or fall on its own merits, and I like it the most. It is written by Ruski. So with this, I'm concluding my talk. And I'm also saying, stop sharing my screen. So I just want to tell that Indian poetry in English is a fathomless ocean where millions of pearls lies hidden in the bottom, and only a few pearls could be focused here. It means the pity done and the undone vast. Only a few themes of few major voices have been explored by me today with a view of getting some ideas about the nature of the genre. The process of recreating the consciousness of Indian poetry in English can be served to some extent by this talk. And furthermore, I think that this kind of talk can urge all us to discover in a more metaphorical and modest way to understand the reflection of this vast genre. A vast number of contemporary and emerging Indian poets writing in English have the potential to engage the academicians and critics in exploring the newness of their poetry today. And I think it is our task to do so in near future. Thank you.
Well, okay. Well, thank you very much. This has been a stunning and absolutely marvelous lecture. It's been much more than just a journey. It's been very vivid, very detailed. And I think you haven't missed many aspects and you haven't missed many poets. However, we do have some questions coming up. We might have questions from our international community. We do have some questions from India, and I suggest that if you'd like to ask a question, you either write it in the chat or you just give a signal. I can't see you all at the same time, so if you want to play it safe, just leave a message in the chat. But we do have two apparently very urgent questions from India. And that is Shaista Rahman and Anupam Soni. Okay. And could I just talk, Shaista Rahman?
I can read the question. Or Matthias, I can read the question.
Okay,
from the chat box.
But he or she probably like to discuss that.
Okay.
So yeah, could somebody give Shaista Rahman a chance to talk? Hello?
Shaista Rahman can unmute herself, yeah, and she can ask the question if she wants to do so. She's telling that, I guess. Will I read the question?
Pardon me?
Will I read the question? The question is visible to me because it is written in the chat box, so I can read.
Okay. Shaista Rahman, go ahead, please.
Hello.
Yep.
Hello, good evening, sir.
Yes.
Sir, I'm Shaista Rahman. I'm from Jharkhand. You have talked of the journey of Indian poetry, and you said that we are now in experimental age and our concern is very Marxist and social issues. But sir, I just find there is gap. There is gap because there the marginalized section, tribal people, they are always try to voicing their issues, but no one acknowledge. So there is gap between a mainstream of poetry, like I have seen Kamala Das. She has starting the trend of confessional kind of poetry, right, sir? So while the tribal people, they started the oral poetry, now they are somehow their regional language translated into English, but they are very less acknowledged. So as I think as a reader, there is gap between the real concern. You talk of so many poets talk of there's a green poet, but still green poets, they just talk of the environmental issues. No one talk of tribal issues. So how we can connect their voice to the mainstream of writing or mainstream of voice? So this is my question.
Okay. Thanks a lot for the question. The answer lies within your question. It is our responsibility to make them acknowledge. Like what I did, what you are doing now. I have tried to bring into focus five contemporary Indian poets and about their works by doing a research on them by how they have tried to explore certain nuances of the society. At the same time, while it is, yes, it is one of the major facts that poetry is not, it is not like that kind of keeping the market like what lucrative fictions and short stories used to do. Hardly we read poetry. Hardly we talk about poetry. But here is the medium we can explore this kind of tribal poets. We can talk of them. We can write on them. And we can publish, we can share their poetry. While they are not being able to give their poetry that kind of momentum, researchers like us can give them a kind of momentum. Researchers like us can do significant work on them. And in that way, they can be explored, they can be read on a large scale by others. It is our responsibility to make them acknowledged. And yes, the marginalized and tribal section in Jharkhand, there are so many tribal poets. Hasda is there. So if we are reading the poets of Hasda or to some other tribal poet, we should inform others. It's a kind of, we need to do a certain kind of marketing to promote our poets. It's not a kind of marketing for the business purpose. It's a kind of marketing to make them people aware. While I'm talking about the green poets, that On Killing a Tree, that the poem that I have also included in my volume that I have published from Sahitya Academy. And this kind of poetry, On Killing a Tree, it is taught in the school curriculum of West Bengal. To make students understand that yes, we shouldn't cut the tree. While we are cutting the tree, it means we are killing the tree. It's not the cut. It's one single knife can do it. The poetry begins like that. So it is our responsibility to read these poets, to explore this poet, to make this poet come into the mainstream of the society. Thank you. Any more questions?
Yeah, Shaista Rahman would actually be quite interested in tribal poetry too. Is there any way we could contact you or you could contact us?
Sorry, sir?
Shaista Rahman, hello. We'd actually be quite interested in tribal poetry. Is there any way we could contact you or you could contact us?
Sir, I'll contact.
All right. You'll find my mail address on the website, the Trier University website. Have you been there?
No, sir.
Well, you. I think. Yeah. We'll continue.
Kannst deine Mail im Chat einfach ihr mitteilen.
Exactly. Marvelous. Thank you. Next question, that is Anupam Soni, Marxist Undercurrents, Anupam Soni. Still there? Nope.
Hello, am I audible?
Yes, you are, absolutely.
Very good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Yeah. Sir, so my question is to Mr. Gautam. Hello, Mr. Gautam.
Yes, yes. Hi.
Can you hear me? Yeah.
Yes, yes.
So, it is nice hearing you from this platform. And my question is that you referred to Marxist undercurrents in the post-independence poetry, era of poetry, but I don't find that kind of resentment or that kind of acute sense of protest in Indian poetry. And my next question is, why Indian poets of present day, especially those who are writing in English, are not addressing the contemporary issues in their poetry? Okay. I have two questions on the line.
Okay.
Yeah.
Now, in the first question, while you were talking about what kind of Marxist undercurrent is going on. Let me tell you and name a few poems. I can tell you that you should go through the poems of K.G. Domini or I.K. Sharma or K.K.N. Yes, Daruwala. These are the poets and their poems are highly Marxist in nature. And let me tell you one of the poems that I am now reading about K.G. Domini. From my book. It's the poem that begins like the silence, silence, grape silence. This is the poem of K.V. Domini. And it starts like that mansion like house, doors and windows closed, past midnight, still lights inside. Clip fears to enter, three generations recite. Grandpa reads Bible, grandma reads Bhagavatam, grandchildren aged 8 and 12 write never ending home war. Their dad is drowned in Facebook, mom buried in WhatsApp, no sound from anywhere. Seems like haunted house, silent, silence, grape silence. Now, what we
Thank
are
you.
Doing,
huh.
what we are doing,
yeah, yeah.
a lever are there, they are burning. So, if we go through the poem, we can see that here also, Dominic or the poets of post-independent era, they are talking about how a certain section of the society, for example, the proletariat, have been explored and they are repeatedly exploited by another class, and they have tried to show their voice, this kind of poem. If we go through the modern poetry also, like the poetry of Sujata Vard, she is rather a feminist, she is rather a post-feminist poet also, and to some extent they are also her Petrichor poems or to some other poems that also talks about how in a certain way a lower section of the society are subjugated, domesticated, exploited. So this kind of poetry can be read from a Marxist perspective. And let me tell you again, social realism is the offspring of Marxism. While Marxist ideology talked about the class conflict, socio-realists, they are not talking about the class conflict. They are talking about making people aware by showing the reality of the society. So there are so many poets and there are so many poems that can be explored from this Marxist perspective.
Thank you, Gautam, sir.
Okay, okay, welcome.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, any more questions from our international community?
I have a question. Thank you very much for your amazing talk, Gautam.
Thanks a lot.
I'm interested in the problem, how many languages of poetry or how many poetries do you have in India? Can you say about this something? And the other question, what do you think, how many percent of Indian poetry is in English?
How many percent? To some extent, in India, there are so many languages, 26 or more than, but in case of West Bengal, so many languages are there, but there are a few good Marathi poets, there are a few good Hindi poets. Those who are writing in the language of Hindi, Marathi poets, they are writing in their own native language. There are a lot of Bengali poets, that is my mother tongue, and they are also writing in a far better way, and to some extent a few poets have been translated, but a lot not translated in the true sense of term. So due to the lack of translation, we are unable to understand the nuances or the gem of that regional poetry, because of the global acceptance of this language, we can understand the importance or the basic features or the gems lies hidden in Indian poetry written in English. But there are so many other languages, and right now at present, I can tell you that Gujarati poetry, Marathi poetry, Hindi poetry, Bengali poetry, and Sauthali poetry, and that to some extent a few tribal poetry, this kind of poetry needs to be translated and explored. And regarding that tribal section that that someone has asked, I am also trying to explore the Indian indigenous poetry in comparison with Australian indigenous poetry. So Indian indigenous poetry is one of the areas that can be explored vividly and needs to pay a lot of attention. But I don't know how much you have enjoyed the nuances of Indian poetry in English, but there are so many other poets and so many other areas also.
Do you have some influences of other languages in the English poetry of India? Is there be a polylingualism in the English poetry, or only the other way around, that the tribal and other huge languages, big languages, are including English and other European languages in the poetry? I read about the influences of other languages on Indian poetry languages, language of Indian poetry in English and Indian languages mixed up in poems.
Yes, to some extent, apart from poems also in novels also, and that Salman Rushdie has coined the term chutneyfication or the code switching. Code switching means in so many Indian poets, I can immediately name Smita Agarwal. She is one of the leading Indian English poets, Indian English women poets, and in her poem, while she is telling that the girl is going wearing bangles, eating samosa with chutney. That samosa and chutney, these are the Hindi words. But she has borrowed these Hindi words into her poem. So yes, this kind of code switching or the language alteration is there. So this kind of chutneyfication is there even in Hindi poems. So many Marathi language or the Gujarati languages are there. In so many, it depends on who is writing. If I am writing a poem, I will try to use a Bengali word in my English poem, so that Bengali word also needs to be read on a global platform. If I am a Marathi, if I am a Gujarati, I will use certain native words into my poetry, so that my native language or native words also get that kind of acceptance, that kind of global acceptance. So yes, we are influenced by other regional language. We are at the same time, we are also using certain Latin words also in our English poem. So we are influenced by other languages other than English. We are influenced by some other Western languages. We are also using to some extent some kind of Russian words also in our poetry. So yes, that kind of code switching is there in our poetry.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. Any more questions? Well, I'd actually have a great many questions and also some observations. One observation is that what you have done by compiling 80 Indian poets for the Lie of the Land is something which has happened in German language poetry as well. In 2003, an anthology has been published called Lyrik von Jetzt. I think you could roughly translate it as poetry today, the poetry of now. And that was a major breakthrough because two poets, Björn Kulig and Jan Wagner, actually brought 80 new poets to the fore and to the attention of the general public, because up until then, there was an older guard of poets who had dominated the scene since, well, late 1940s. You could actually say, since the so-called Group 47, Gruppe 47. And it is quite exciting to see that something similar might be happening in India. So these parallels are interesting. My question, however, goes into another direction. I think in an interview with Sunil Sharma, you came across the apparently deplorable state of poetry in India. But what is the state of poetry in India nowadays? Are there many readers? Who is actually reading poetry in English? And who? What kind of people, what is their background? Who writes poetry in English?
This is a very cheeky question. And let me tell you shamelessly that in India, the market of poetry is at present not a very good one. And in my anthology also, there are so many poets, like the one you mentioned, Sunil Sharma. He's a good poet. Poet like Sunil Sharma or G.F. Patel or Sanjukta Dasgupta or Shanta Acharya or Siddhartha Bose or T.V. Reddy, they should be explored more and more in a more vivid way, but they are not getting, people are not doing research on them. All are hankering after some kind of lucrative fiction, short stories, mm-hmm. and dramas. That's the problem. For example, I am telling you, Tavish Kher is one of the notable diasporic Indian poets writing in English. He's a wonderful poet, but till now, only a single research work has been done on Tavish Kher, on his poetry. There in India, there is a site, Shodh Ganga, or in Flipnet, where all our theses, all our doctoral theses have stored. And I can guess that as you have come across few of my interviews, then you will certainly search Shodh Ganga, and you will come to know that a lot of theses, a lot of works are there on Jayanta Mohapatra, on Nisim Ezekiel, on Toru Dutta, on Sarojini Naidu, on Aurobindo. It means, till 1980s, you can see a lot of research works on this poet. These poets have been explored repeatedly on the same theme. They have been explored by numerous researchers. There is not a single one who has done research on contemporary poets. The five poets that I have chosen, on them, there is not a single thesis. And in my research work also, only a few stray articles are there. In my this book also, among this 80 poets, now this will be a kind of controversial term to use, that established or the good or bad poet. But often I have come across this fact that there are so many poets, those who don't want to be associated with other poems, keeping in mind the standardity of their poem and their poem, that I can't be in the same anthology where he or she is contributing. So this kind of conflict of interest is there in India. I don't know in some other countries, but to some extent here in India, we are facing the same problem. And regarding the background of these poets, few are elitist, few are not. But the problem is that here in India, the market or the marketing of poetry is not at all good. Very few chances are there, and very few are there to work on poetry. I feel privileged to the publishers who have published me. Otherwise, in India, if we for example, you all know from Routledge, from Peter Lang, from Vernon, from Palgrave, there is not a single book on Indian poetry. Not a single book has been published by this kind of presses. Whenever I have tried to send them the manuscript, they told only one single thing: who will read the book? who will be the possible readers? And each time I fail to answer this one single question, then who will be the readers? This is the problem of reading poetry in India, publishing poetry in India, publishing articles on poetry in India. And here, to some extent, we see the marketability of each and every genre. Yeah. While we are reading Chitra Banerjee Divakaruni, while we are reading other so many novelists and their works, they can be explained. Yes.
This is stretching. We know it in a way from Germany, but we don't have much time left. And there are two more questions. There is one question by Klaus Telgenau.
Well, Guten Kamaka, thank you so much for your inspiring talk. I was wondering, I mean, you were labeling, like a great deal of poetry you were talking about, you were labeling it as experimental. Maybe you can elaborate on that a bit. Because I did some research on an Indian poet writing in English, and his name, you're probably familiar with his work, his name is Ranjit Hoskote, whose work has always been also been translated into German. And for instance, in his poetry, you find a lot of like intermingling, intertwining of poetry and painting. So I was wondering if this is something that other Indian poets are picking up upon, like Indian poets writing in English, of course. So yeah, thank you.
Yes. To some extent, like Ranjit Hoskote, there is Dilip Chitre also, and there is Giyat Patel also, who is also a painter, and in their poetry, and to some extent, let me quote you the name Sudip Sen. Sudip Sen also one of the leading Indian poets, whose poetry can be read as a prime example of verbal visual poetry, where there are certain kind of paintings, and at the same time, there are lines also written on those paintings, beside those paintings. So yes. To some extent, he is also experimenting a lot with the meter and the rhyme also. And apart from them, there is another woman poet. Her name is Rochelle Potkar. She is also trying to write some kind of prose poetry. So yes, experimental poetry is going on, and too many experiments also are going on. And all this we are gracefully accepting and welcoming.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, there is one last question by Angelika Schmidt.
Yeah, thank you very much for this great talk. I had the idea maybe, but you were talking about research on Indian English poetry abroad, but maybe in India there's not so lot research or not so much interest in it because of the rise of nationalism in the last years. Is this possible?
Yes. Are you talking about nationalism in terms of pre-independent Indian English poetry? To what extent? It means, want to know about the nationalist trends can we find in contemporary Indian English poetry?
I think she means the BJP government, the shift to the right, which you probably also experience in Purulia.
Yes, I think it's not common to write in English if you have such a government.
No.
I'm also wondering how can you write national Indian poetry in English? You have to write in Hindi or
it's nothing like that while BJP is there, we have to write everything in Hindi only. We are allowed to write in English, and we are writing in English, and in this context, let me quote you what Kamala Das told, that she was Malayalam, but he told that yes, I can choose my own language, the language which I like most. So to some extent, these are the poets they like English language the most, and that is why they have written or they are writing poetry in English, And also to some extent, then there are so many nationalist poets that they are who are writing in Hindi, and their poems can be taken as the propaganda of the BJP government. Also, they are also upholding the or the praising the certain acts of BJP government through their poems. In time and again, when the government will want or when they will feel the need, they will translate those poetry in English, or their poetry will be translated to know everyone the good deeds that BJP government is doing or has done for India. So it's about, to some extent, this kind of translation or this kind of reading and writing to some extent is politically connected also. Mm-hmm. To some extent.
Thank you.
Okay, well, I think we're coming to a close and to an end now. And thank you very much for having given that wonderful talk, or Donobad in Bengal. It's been absolutely stunning. It's been an enrichment to our research group. And thank you everybody else for having taken part in our Zoom meeting. And
thanks a lot. Thanks to you all. Thanks, Matthias. Thanks, Professor Hendrika Stoll, for giving me this wonderful opportunity. I'm extremely grateful to all of you. Thanks. Thanks a lot.
Okay.
Thanks, Katina. And thanks to all the participants. Thanks to all the group members doing excellent work in them. It's my honor and extreme privilege to have you all in this platform. And let me give you this time to talk about my nation, about the kind of poetry that we used to read from our childhood days. So it's a kind of great privilege, and it's something that, yes, today I think and I feel that, yes, I did something for the growth and development of poetry, that you all have come to know about a few name of this leading poets like Ranjit Hoskote. There are so many other poets whose name should come across in near future also in the discussion. So I'm extremely grateful to all of you.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you very much. Bye-bye.